This is the Pulse of St. Louis.
Welcome to the Pulse of St. Louis. I'm Shirley Washington. You know, the Gateway City is hosting its inaugural STL Startup Week throughout the region, November 1st through the 9th. And the event is designed to celebrate the success of small business owners, startups, and entrepreneurs. Joining me now, Dr. Erica Barnell. She is the Chief Science Officer and co-founder of Geneoscopy. Dr. Nadia Shakoor, she is CEO and co-founder of Agrela Ecosystems. Tylesha Summers, she is co-founder of Spendebt. And Phyllis Ellison, Vice President of Partnership and Program Development for Cortex and Community Organizer of STL Startup Week. Thank you all so much for being here. I appreciate it. Phyllis, this sounds like an incredible event. Tell us about it. Give us the backstory about how it came about.
We are so excited to have STL Startup Week kicking off here. This is actually a discussion that's been going on for 7 or 8 years. And every year everyone says we really should be doing this. Denver has a great Startup Week. Kansas City has a great Startup Week. We have so many fabulous resources here in St. Louis, we should be doing one as well to really showcase what we have. So this year has been the time that we got about 25, 30 organizations together at the table who said, yes, we want to do this. It's important to showcase what we have in the region. And there are even more people here that could take advantage of the resources that we have.
And let's talk about the resources. What's available?
There are different events and activities for mentoring and coaching, funding resources, our co-working spaces, the offices and labs, and even a professional kitchen. You have a chance to visit all of that.
So I want to talk about each of your respective businesses. So let's start with you first, Dr. Barnell, and work our way down the line, okay?
Absolutely. So as mentioned, I'm the Chief Science Officer at Geneoscopy. We are a healthcare startup company that's non-invasively assessing gastrointestinal health to potentially replace eliminating colonoscopies for patients with colorectal cancer, Crohn's, ulcerative colitis, things like that.
Now, how did that come about?
Yeah. My undergraduate research was focused on environmental enteropathy. We were looking at non-specific inflammation for kids in Africa, and we were really successful at isolating eukaryotic or human cells from stool samples. And I thought, you know, this would be a great opportunity to apply to other gastrointestinal diseases, such as colorectal cancer or Crohn's, which is a huge problem in the United States. So we took that technology out of the university at WashU and started Geneoscopy.
That is awesome. Dr. Shakoor, tell us about your business, please.
Sure. So I'm the CEO of Agrela Ecosystems, and we're an ag tech startup that started here in St. Louis out of the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center. And I'm also a research scientist there. And a few years ago, I really needed an affordable and scalable platform to monitor what was happening out in our crop fields. And so myself and some colleagues, we developed a platform called the Phenode. It's basically a technology that sits out in the field, gathers data from a whole suite of different sensors, and transmits them to the cloud and onto your cell phone or your tablet. And with technologies like the Phenode, our mission as a company is to really lower that barrier to entry for advanced crop improvement technologies for researchers like myself, and ultimately develop these type of technologies, high quality research devices for farmers as well.
Wow, that's incredible. Tylesha, tell us about Spendebt.
Sure. Spendebt is a financial technology company that helps people pay off debt as they spend money. So whether in debt or not, we know that people will continue to spend money, and Spendebt works in parallel with everyday spending habits. So how it works is every time a user makes a debit transaction, they can set a predefined amount. So let's say it's a dollar, and that's added to every debit transaction. And at the end of the month, we aggregate those micropayments, and we send a one-time payment on behalf of the user to their creditor of choice.
That's incredible. It sounds like it will help them pay off their debt sooner rather than later.
Absolutely.
Is that correct?
Absolutely. And so one area where we're focusing on is going into universities and getting students, letting them know, like, you can pay off your debt now. You don't have to wait until you graduate college and get hit, right, from all the bill collectors,
right.
And Sally Mae coming.
Because they will be calling.
That's right. That's right. So start now.
You have an engineering background, correct?
Yes. I'm a chemical engineer by degree, and my husband, who's the founder of the company, is an electrical engineer.
Wow, that's impressive. So Phyllis, just fill us in, because this is really incredible to see all these women starting all of these businesses, you know, and work. Let's talk numbers. What are we seeing in that regard?
So in St. Louis, we are ranked number 2 in the country for the number of women entrepreneurs, and it's estimated that about 45% of the startups in the region are started by women. So it's really impressive to see that many women coming into the business place. And obviously we've got a great selection of women here that have wonderful technical backgrounds as well. And seeing an increase of women founded companies in those fields.
So tell me about the kinds of support that women get, especially as they attend your event that's coming up November 1st.
So across all of our organizations, there are 75 support organizations in St. Louis that provide different stages of support, mentoring, maybe even providing a potential founder that can partner with the existing founder and provide some of the business expertise that pairs up really well with a technical background. So a whole range of support like that. During the week, there are a couple different events. The WISER event, Women in Science, Entrepreneurship, and Research, is on November 1st. We also have, so you have a great chance to hear different speakers and learn about technology there. There are a couple different events through the week, and we end up on Friday, November 8th, with a panel for women founders that will be held at ThriveCo in Clayton. So there are different places in the region. So geography, you can find something in your neighborhood. You can also find something that really pertains to the industry that you're in, or again, finding coworkers and co-founders that are going down the same journey and path that you are.
Is this event open to the public?
So all of these events are open to the public. Almost all of them are free. A few of them have a small fee related to them. And the website, stlewisstartupweek.com, outlines all of these. People can select the events that really relate to them and pick the ones that are meaningful. This is not a week of speakers where you have to show up on Monday and you listen to speakers through Friday. This is really picking and choosing the events that pertain most to your interest and to the field that you're working in.
That's awesome. Dr. Shakoor, let's talk about some of the challenges that you may have encountered when you started your business and how did you overcome them? And that's a question, Talisha, I also want you to answer, and Dr. Barnell as well.
Yeah, so I mean, like any startup, I think our biggest challenge has been raising capital. And so we were really lucky in 2017 through St. Louis, we received an Arch Grants, and that really kickstarted our sort of fundraising and efforts. And you know, we've, like Phyllis mentioned, we've had a lot of really great resources here in St. Louis that have helped us along the way. Groups like BioSTL providing financial support, or iSelect providing advisory support. We've had a lot of support in that way.
Yeah, that's awesome. Talisha, what about you?
Yeah, so I would mimic the same. So from St. Louis, we actually became a part of Arch Grant. So we were 2018 Arch Grant recipients. So capital was our challenge. So they provided us with an equity-free grant, and we actually relocated from Houston up to St. Louis. So they brought us back, and my husband's originally from St. Louis, so it was coming back home for him. And so then, in addition, since we've been here, we've been a part of I-10, which helps you as one of those 75 entities across the St. Louis area. And recently, we became a part of Capital Innovators, which also provided us funding and resources, mentors, helping us with marketing. I mean, you name it. I mean, there's a resource out in St. Louis to help you with it, no matter what stage of your company.
That's great stuff. Dr. Barnell, what about you? Challenges, and how did you overcome them?
Yeah, our biggest challenge was more surrounding the lab space and building out the infrastructure required to execute our clinical trials. So we were fortunate enough to have space provided to us at the Cortex District and Biogenerator, and we had access to a lot of shared equipment that we needed that we couldn't invest in, you know, being a small startup. It was provided to us for free or at cost, which allowed us to execute a lot of clinical trials that supported and validated our Series A execution that happened this fall.
That's incredible. Phyllis, talk a little bit about the importance of networking and being in the same space, creating all these wonderful ideas, because I know it's inspiring.
It's incredibly inspiring, and it is important. It should not be underestimated. The value of sharing ideas and to learn from each other. Being an entrepreneur can be rather lonely. You may not have coworkers, or even your partner may be in a different city or a different location. So getting a chance to share ideas on a regular basis, get feedback, talk to experts in the industry, talk to potential customers to make sure you're on the right path and producing a product or a service that people actually want. Getting that feedback sooner and more frequently is really critical to the success of these companies and how they grow.
And as the women pointed out, financing is a huge challenge.
Yes.
So what resources are available to address that need?
Financing is a challenge for every startup. It has nationally been a challenge, especially for equity investment. It's been a challenge for women. And so there is an awareness building campaign here in St. Louis to really make sure whether it's about hiring, whether it's about investing, whether it's about making sure we've got mentors and support services available for women. It's making people conscious of the choice and to not just pick people that look like you do when you're putting your time and effort into these companies. And I think that's helped raise awareness and put an emphasis on the fact that we need to be investing in all good technologies, no matter who's running them.
It sounds like this is an exciting time to be in St. Louis for entrepreneurs and startups.
This is an incredibly exciting time. We've really been growing this community for about 15 years, which feels like a long time, but to grow a really robust startup community, it's a 30 to 40 year effort. So we're still growing as a community. We have some great organizations, and it's fabulous to see companies coming into the marketplace year after year. Like you said, it's inspiring. And I love that I get to go to work every day and meet people like this group that are doing great things and bringing things into the marketplace.
They are impressive. Tylisha, are you attending the conference Startup Week?
Absolutely.
What do you hope to get out of it?
Meeting people and connecting. It would be great, obviously, if we could have connections with investors and be able to speak with them one-on-one. We'll actually be having a booth next week, and then as a part of Arch Grants, we'll be participating and pitching our company to a room full of investors. So it's really networking and meeting investors as much as we can.
Awesome. Dr. Shakoor, what about you?
Very similar type activities. I'm participating in the Wiser Conference on a panel as well. Startup Connection will have a booth there also, and the Arch Grants pitch as well. So there's a lot of fun things happening this week.
Yeah, Dr. Barnell?
We're growing, so we're looking to expand our team and try to bring some good talent into the company. And so that's what I hope to get out of the Startup Connection.
Nice. When you make that pitch, Tylisha, what goes into it? Because I understand it's intense.
It's intense, but you really, depending on how much time you have, typically when you do a pitch, it's like 3 to 5 minutes. So you really need to focus on what do you need to convey to the audience to get to that next conversation? Like, that's the goal. You can't fit everything realistically in a 3 to 5 minutes about what you've done and all the great, you know, progress you've made. So it's what are those key points that at least get you to that next conversation? And that's what you need to focus on.
Well, I want to thank you all so much for being here, and thank you so much for what you're doing, and congratulations on your projects. Phyllis, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
so much.
You.
Thank you
so much.
Hey, John, let's put on the screen one more time where the conference is going to be. There it is, STL Startup Week, November 1st through the 9th. And I understand there's a big event, Phyllis, November 4th from 9 to 10:30. And this is at Innovation Hall in Cortex, 4220 Duncan Avenue. And straight ahead on the Pulse of St. Louis, this.
Do I groove? Is it thrilling?
St. Louis's very own legendary singer Denise Thimes drops by to discuss her upcoming concert, which benefits pancreatic cancer. Stay with us. We are back in a moment.
To hear more, listen to the podcast. Just search for The Pulse of St. Louis.
My baby don't care for shoes. My baby don't care for clothes. My baby just cares for me. My baby don't care for cars and races. My baby don't care for high-tone places. Meg Ryan is
not my spot. That is the one and only legendary singer Denise Thimes showcasing her phenomenal talent. She is performing at the 15th annual Mildred Thimes Foundation benefit concert for pancreatic cancer research. The concert is Thursday, October 31st at the Sheldon Concert Hall. That is located at 3648 Washington Boulevard in St. Louis. Now, there is a reception that starts at 5:30, but the concert starts at 7:30. Tickets are available at MetroTix. And joining me now, the one, the only, Denise Thimes. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me, Shirley.
Oh my gosh. I was looking at that video, and I was like, she's working it. Oh my stars.
Oh my goodness. I've been doing this so long, I better do something right.
How long have you been singing?
I have been singing professionally for about 30 6 years.
No.
Yeah.
No. Mm-hmm. And it seems like you can do any genre of music.
I try.
Jazz, blues, pop, you can do it all.
I try to keep myself, you know, open to those different styles. But, you know, jazz and, of course, gospel are my babies.
Did you start in the church?
I absolutely started in the church, Sunny Mount Baptist Church, new Sunny Mount Baptist Church now. And yeah, you know, my church was what pretty much prepared me for the arts. And then, of course, I went to Spelman College after that, and, you know, and then theater, and started with the St. Louis Black Repertory when I got back here. And, you know, the Bosman twins hooked me up in the jazz world, them and Bill Tucker, and the rest is history, you know.
Wow.
So, yeah.
And now you've started this incredible foundation in honor of your mom.
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Well, in 1997, I lost my mom to pancreatic cancer. I was actually in Singapore when my mother was diagnosed with this disease. I had 3 weeks to come back to St. Louis, which felt like 3 months when I found out my mom had cancer. Returning, I knew nothing about this disease. I asked different ones in Singapore. No one had heard of it except for a few people. And one guy mentioned to me that he had a friend whose mom had it and she had passed like within 6 months of knowing. And so that didn't help any. I came home and, you know, I was just really desperately trying to find out, what is this disease? Why is it fatal to the point where there's no return? In other words, there was just nothing the doctors could do but the chemo. And at that time, the chemo that they were giving my mom probably was just a general chemo that, you know, they give to cancer patients. But, you know, now, you know, thank God, the people at Siteman Cancer Center, they're able to really do a lot more things with chemo and the treatment of pancreatic cancer now. But I've always and still am on this search as to why we cannot cure pancreatic cancer. Why does it have to be such a no turning back disease?
Did it impact your mom quickly?
Fortunately, we had our mom for 11 months. And so the doctor had given her 6. But, you know, we were blessed to have her for 11 months.
Yeah, yeah. How did that impact you, though, watching your mom go through that?
Thank you for that question. You know, I had to grow up real quick. Although I was in my early 30s, I had my son, but I still had not grown up yet, in a sense. And so, of course, myself and my sisters, we all had to, you know, get it together. We had to be mom. And believe me, it took all 4 of us to be mom. So that was the main thing that I remember, having to have to deal with things that, you know, I really hadn't dealt with yet in my life. You know, so.
And that's hard.
Yeah, it was.
That's hard.
It really was.
To see your mom.
But, you know, I guess for me, and it was just seeing my dad every day, who, it's interesting enough, but it wasn't until later on in life that I thought about what it meant to my father to come home every day to a dying wife. And you're still, of course, sleeping in the same bed, and to know that one day when you turn over, that person is not going to be there. So I had to get busy, and I needed to know, what is this thing that has taken my mom?
Yeah.
And I've been on that journey ever since. Mm-hmm. For 15 years, I've been on that journey.
Wow. And you've been doing a great job raising funds for pancreatic cancer research.
Thank you.
Doing it again this year, October
yes.
31st, with the
yes.
concert. Tell me about the concert. What can fans expect?
Yeah. The concert is of course, very exciting. I'm going to start with the VIP reception that starts at 5:30. Normally, we have the wonderful Dr. Lannis Hall, who comes in to do a Q&A and sort of give us more information on, you know, pancreatic cancer and other things that we've talked about at this event. This year, we have Dr. Ade Tunji from Siteman Cancer Center, And we also have Dr. Carolyn Henry from the Ellis Fischel Cancer Center in Columbia, Missouri. And so they're going to be our two guest doctors to talk about pancreatic cancer and the different things that have happened with it. So I'm excited about that and hearing that information. We're bringing in our special guest comedian, the fantastic Monique Marvez. She is absolutely funny. And I am doing a musical tribute to just two male crooners that I feel are so underrated, very well known, but I think underrated. That's Al Jarreau and Michael Franks. And then I'm adding some Otis Redding and some Teddy Pendergrass in there.
So. What? You know that's going to be an awesome night.
It's going to be an awesome
that's
night.
Be an awesome night.
Bring your grown folk yeah. hat.
I love that. I love that. And you're right. Al Jarreau was just a phenomenal, amazing singer.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah.
I saw him perform twice at the Two Hill.
Uh-huh.
Blew me away each time.
Well, you know, I was blessed to be in his presence through the wonderful Mr. David Stewart, because he actually had Al Jarreau to come in to celebrate his wife's birthday. So, you know, before, you know, and I was just, you know, that's the beautiful thing about, you know, we can go on about that wonderful man, but you know, that's that was so wonderful that he hired Mr. Jarreau in his latter years. You know, and in this business, you know, to get hired in your latter years, mm-hmm. That's a wonderful mm-hmm. thing, mm-hmm. yeah.
You have sung for a president of the U.S., right?
Yes.
You've sung for Aretha Franklin.
Yes.
On her birthday?
On her 71st birthday.
That's incredible to me.
Thank you.
What was that like for you?
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. Had to pinch myself. This Aretha Franklin is, she's my heart. This is the woman that I grew up wanting to be her, sing like her, everything. Got exposed to her at a very early age, at about 9 years old. Because Aretha Franklin's first album, when she came out on the scene, was a blues album. They didn't know where to put Aretha because she has such a gospel sound in her voice that she certainly couldn't do jazz. So they tried her off with blues on Decca. And my father had that album, and that's when I first heard Aretha Franklin, and I was in love ever since. So my dad, being in the promoting business as well, promoted Aretha twice. She came to our house twice. And I was excited, and I followed her everywhere she went in our house, because that was the lady who I heard on that album that I wanted to be like. And so again, through the wonderful Dr. Lannis Hall, she had a 75th birthday party for her father in Detroit, and Aretha was there. And I, can I tell you about the phone call?
Oh,
do we have
goodness.
Time
okay,
for
wait,
that?
Wait. I want you to tell me about the phone call.
Okay.
I got to take a break first.
Okay.
When we come back, we're going to tell you how you can get involved with the Mildred Thimes Foundation. And we're going to hear this story about the phone call. Stay with us. Back in a moment. Yes.
It's real.
Welcome back. We are talking with the one and only Denise Thimes. And before we went to break, remember, she said, I want to tell you about the phone call. Okay, so tell us about the phone
call. So I got this call, came in anonymous, and I answered the phone, you know, just, you know, okay, yeah. you know, salesperson.
Right.
May I speak with Denise? Speaking. Denise, this is Aretha Franklin. So, of course, you know.
No.
I went crazy. And I was calling her Miss Franklin the whole time. Miss Franklin, Miss Franklin, Miss Franklin. She said, look, don't be calling me Miss Franklin. You ain't no spring chicken.
She had a sense of humor.
Yes, yes.
Oh, my gosh.
To say the least.
Yeah. That's amazing, though,
yeah,
to be able
yeah.
to have that memory and that moment
yeah.
with
yeah.
such a legend.
Yeah,
and you were
you.
Talking about her blues album. I remember her gospel album,
oh, Amazing Grace. Yes.
Every time I hear it, I get chills.
Yes.
Listen to it often.
Yes.
All
an
right.
incredible
so,
album.
As part of the upcoming concert, there is also a special family support segment. Tell me about that.
We are supporting a wonderful family, the Thompson family. A young lady by the name of Kanisha, who came to us at 39 years old with twin beautiful girls, high school age, has been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer.
So donations can be brought to Beloved Community Methodist
Church? Donations can be brought to Beloved Community Methodist Church on Monday, October 28th at 6:30 p.m. We are in for toiletries, items, you know, Kleenex, tissue, toothpaste, toothbrushes, lotion, soap, Vaseline, you know.
Whatever you can
whatever give. You can give.
Yeah. All right. And then your concert Thursday, October 31st.
Yes.
At the Sheldon
Concert
Hall.
All right. Michael Franks and Al Jarreau.
I know, right? All right. Thank you, Ms. Thimes,
thank
for being
you,
here.
Shirley.
And thank you for joining us for the Pulse of St. Louis. Remember, if you missed any part of the show, download the Pulse of St. Louis podcast in the iTunes or Google Play stores. I'll see you next time.